Good evening. Welcome to our home concert. And we want to thank Riverfolk Music and Arts for providing this opportunity for us and the opportunity for you to support Riverfolk and their concerts, which they're presenting every single Thursday. So I'm Mr. B, and I'm happy to be here with you. We're here at my home, and some of you may know, and those that don't, I'm happy to tell you that this is something we've been doing every single weekday at 5:30 p.m. for a happy half hour, live at the Beehive, on my Facebook page, which is MRB Piano. And we're here every weekday, and we've done 27 episodes, in fact, so far. So I'm getting more comfortable with this. And having said that, I think we'll start right off with some music for you. We were able to catch part of Mad Cat's set, which I'm hoping you guys saw. Great job, you know, like you'd expect. So good job, Peter. And I'm going to try to take over from there and drive the bus for about 50 minutes or so. So we're going to start off with the first piece of music, which is particularly since we're doing this through an organization that's interested in tradition and folk music and so forth. I'm going to put a little bit of that spin on what we do here this evening. And so to begin with, I want to start with one of the very oldest and interesting of the piano blues, which comes from East Texas and comes from the brother of Sippy Wallace, who many of you may remember as having been a great classic blues singer, one of the greatest of all time, in fact, and lived a lot of her life in Detroit. But her family in their early years were in Texas, and she had a brother named Hersel Thomas that wrote this first blues. This is called the Suitcase Blues. And last thing before I begin, I want to welcome you to send questions my way, please, or comments. And we're going to make this interactive, and at least one time, maybe throughout, I'll be able to answer your questions about the music and so forth. So please feel free to do that. It'll have a better sense of community if you take advantage of that opportunity. So we hope you do. Let's begin with the Suitcase Blues, all right? Thank you. That's the suitcase blues. Thank you, Wendy.
You can speak up loud too.
All right. All right. We have some comments that have come in already. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that first piece. And let's see. Hey, Marianne is back again. Catherine Graham from Kalamazoo. Rick's here. All right.
Laurel's watching.
Laurel's watching, my sis. Oh. All right, sis. I know what you like. I'll get to it eventually. All right. Thank you so much. Please feel free to make any questions at any time, and Wendy will help me keep track of them, of the questions as well, and we'll try to stay up with you and see if we can make it work like that, okay? So that is one of the very, very, very old pieces in the piano blues, very, very old piece, and I like the feel of it a lot. It, like so many of the early blues piano pieces, it has to do with borrowed heavily and frequently from the sounds of the trains. We'll talk more about that later. But before we go too much further at all, too, I want to bust out a boogie-woogie right away, okay? And this is, again, one of the very earliest of the piano boogie-woogies. In fact, this is the very first boogie-woogie that was published as such. That is to say that when you took the product home, it said boogie-woogie on the label. And I'm realizing, if you'll forgive me, that we have a copy of it right here. This is the 78 RPM set that was issued on the Brunswick label of Pinetop Smith playing his Pinetop Blues. Now, the reason Pinetop was called Pinetop, he was like all the early pioneering blues pianists in the Deep South. He was African American. But he had a shock of blondish red hair on the top of his head, just a little bit in his head. And people say that he looked like Georgia Pine in the summertime. So he was always known as Pine Top. Okay? Here we go. This is the Pine Top's Boogie Woogie. Are you ready? Those of you at home, put your seat belts on securely. All right. Pine Top's Boogie Woogie. Thank you. Tops Boogie Woogie. Again, that comes from Clarence Pine Top Smith, and the year was 1928. Okay, let's check and see what we got here. Annette Frank. All right. Oh, all right. First time someone's seen me streaming. Yeah, probably first time many times. This is a mechanism that we're really glad we have. You know, it's I'm not going to harp too long on how disappointed it is that we can't see one another, because I don't think I have anything to add to that discussion that hasn't occurred to each and every one of you. And I just want to try to lighten the load with the means that we have here at our disposal, and brighten your day a little bit. That's what being a musician has always been all about, and that's still what it's about, and it's still working. It's just different, you know. And there will be better days. There will be days that we'll get together again and look each other in the eye and hear each other laugh and share a comment with each other directly about what we think about the music, for good or for bad. But in the meantime, we still have opportunities to be kind to each other and reach out to each other and share our passions and perspectives with each other. So that's what we're doing here tonight. So that is the Pine Tops Boogie Woogie. And before we're done tonight, we're going to take kind of a stroll through blues piano history, and I'll tell a few stories about a few of the key players and let you know a little bit about the tradition. And but I'm also going to make sure to play probably more than a handful of original pieces for you too, which I've has been for me the most fascinating part of continuing to learn to play the piano. So let's start off with one which has been a favorite of a lot of people that have been around to listen to me over the years. And it has a nice story with it, which I've had the opportunity to tell before, but I think I probably have some new people tuning in that maybe not have heard me before, with many thanks to Riverfolk for that. So I will tell the story again. And if you'd like to hear it in a longer form, it's also, you can find it on Here and Now. National Public Radio broadcasted a feature on me in 2015, and I shared some of this story. But so when I was very young and trying to learn how to play blues piano, the only way to learn how to do it, because this is an oral tradition, and I mean that A-U-R-A-L, we don't learn from reading music or from buying sheet music or from having weekly lessons with a piano teacher. We learn by listening to recordings and training our ear and copying what we hear. And if the situation presents itself, we track people down that can teach us. And that's what I did when I was a young guy, and I did a whole lot of it. And I got in some crazy harebrained circumstances trying to learn how to play the piano. But one nice story is that I went to Cornell Street on the south side of Chicago in Hyde Park to the home of Uriel Montgomery, who was always known to blues and jazz fans around the world as Little Brother Montgomery. And he was born 1906, Kentwood, Louisiana. And he played in a lumber mill there where his father worked from the age of about six. He played the piano. And he became one of the most significant and unique of the early Southern blues, barrel house blues, and boogie woogie piano players, and helped create what is the tradition now that we look back on and enjoy. And so I tracked him down. I learned where he lived. Of course, this is way before any sort of internet services or anything. He didn't know I was coming, and I knocked on his door, and he was a little bit of a curmudgeonly guy. These are his hats, by the way, behind me. Right here, that's part of the story, I guess. I jumped ahead. And he was a little curmudgeonly, didn't really want to be very welcoming, didn't know who this kid was begging on his door, you know. And eventually, I guess he sensed my sincerity, I hope, I can only guess. And he rather begrudgingly allowed me in, and we went upstairs and went into his front room where he had a little upright piano, a small console. And he asked me if I'd like to play a little bit, you know, and so I said yes. And I started to play. And as soon as I started to play, he just left the room, just walked right out of the room. And I was so crestfallen, I didn't even have enough courage to quit playing. I mean, my only place of hiding and safety was to just with the piano to keep playing. So what the heck, I just kept playing the piano, you know. And I'm telling you, it went on for a little while. And eventually I heard a knock on the door. And brother made his way back through the room, walked over to the door, and there was Sonny Land Slim, one of the giants of blues piano. And apparently, brother had called him up and said, "Sonny, you got to get over here." He said, "This kid sounds just like you when he plays the blues on a piano," which was, you know, the highest kind of praise you could ever hope for. And I spent the next few hours with both those guys, all taking turns. They treated me as an equal, which I certainly was not even anywhere close. And we took turns playing for each other, round robin, and just had a ball. And it's one of my fondest memories of, and one of my fondest rewards. The lesson there maybe to kids is, don't be shy about reaching, you know, for your dreams and trying to find anybody that can help you that you think might even possibly be able to help you with anything you're interested in. Because usually people that have really deep and abiding interests in topics are more than willing to share when they see a sincere young person that's reaching out to them. I found that to be true over and over and over again. So that's that story. With that as a background, let me play you a piece that I wrote as a tribute to little brother Montgomery, which I was able to play for him before his passing. And this is my ballad called Little Brother. This goes out to my sister, Laurel. Thank you. brother. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. I'm saying thank you because I'm hoping you like that. I'm feeling like you probably did. So my thanks to you. Thanks for being here once again. And thanks again to Riverfolk Music and Arts, because it's my understanding that they are providing a concert for you each and every Thursday. And that's just terrific, you know. So if you'll check their website, I think they have it very clearly marked what their future schedule is, and you'll be able to see what you can look forward to, okay? So let me take a look. I was also asked by Riverfolk, which I think I mentioned at the beginning, that we'd like to encourage, they particularly encourage me to encourage you to ask questions about the music. So if you'd care to do that, they're most welcome in the comments. I can kind of keep up with you. And Wendy is keeping an eye out here too. So, well, thank you, Elaine. Thank you very much. That's a kind comment. And, all right. I don't think I've missed anything else. There's Peter's smiling face from having finished his set just before me. Yeah, okay. All right, let's keep going. When you start to write music on the piano, or I suppose in any other instrument, there are untold ways and means in which to do so. And mine has often been through an expression of gratitude or appreciation to a particular person. That has often been the case for me, not in all cases, but in many cases. And so I think it's important, even when I wrote music as tributes to other pianists like this, I never made any effort to attempt to play like them. I think that would be a big mistake, but just to express in the most natural and honest way I can the feelings that I felt in hearing them do what they did. So that was the case with that last piece. And the next piece I'd like to play for you right now is another original piece of music. In this case, this was written to and for another individual who, he's well known in the Ann Arbor area, and is one of the biggest friends of creative music that we have here in the Ann Arbor area, of all realms, classic, jazz, blues. Extremely knowledgeable guy with a deep and abiding love for the music. And you know him as Dr. Art Wolf. And so I wrote this piece for him a long, long time ago, and he used it as his theme song for his broadcast, which he initiated. It's now carried on at the station, but he created the show, and it's called My Sunday Best. His show was called The Sunday Best, and my piece was called My Sunday Best. So after I wrote the piece, he started using it as his theme music, and recently he chimed in to us here during one of our Live at the Beehive concerts every weekday at 5:30. He said, it was so kind what he said. He said he never had another piece of music that he had more comments on ever. Mm. And boy, that sure meant a lot to me. So I'd like to play this piece for you now. The story behind this is that I lived for about two years, I think it could have been a little longer, directly next to a Kojic church, Church of God in Christ. And there's a lot of very expressive and revved up music making in those churches. And when I say I live next door to it, I mean that when I would lay my head down to go to sleep Sunday morning, I would have my head and then the wall, then a driveway, the wall of the church, and the Hammond organ. So I heard that thing, and I heard it a lot, and it was really inspired me, the sounds that I heard out of their church. In fact, one of my biggest regrets in my whole music career is that one day while I was practicing on my piano, some of the church members came up the porch and knocked on the door, the screen door, And I came out to speak with them. They say, hey, listen, we've been hearing you play the piano, and we think you'd be perfect for our church. We need a piano player. And man, I chickened out. I chickened out. I didn't know if I was ready for it culturally, if I was ready for it from the house of worship. And most importantly, I didn't know if I had the chops to pull it off. And I chickened out. And man, did I lose out. But anyway, I was good neighbors with them, and we liked each other a lot. And I remember Big Joe Duskin would come to town, the blues piano player from Cincinnati, and he'd sit with me on the porch Sunday morning so he could see all the church ladies come to church with their hats and their dresses. He would just nod, and he enjoyed that quite a lot. So I have some good memories of that. But I'd like to play the piece now, finally. This is called My Sunday Best. Thank you. the best. Fantastic. Oh, thank you. That felt good. Feels good to do this. Yeah. The word I think that we're all hearing, and it must be real, is connection, you know, and just all missing those connections. I particularly am a very, as my partner Wendy will attest, very social person. I could have people over every night, you know, or go to someone's house for dinner and hang and be with them and listen and, you know, get added to by them. You take little parts of them that they shed, their thoughts and their feelings and their observations yourself, and you add them to yourself. And so I'm missing that. I'm doing all the work now. So I do miss those connections. And this is the closest thing we have. And again, it's the device that I have to rely on to try to do what is most meaningful to me in my life, which is to play the piano and share with others. So this is the chosen medium. So thanks again for being here. Thanks for supporting me throughout this concert at the Facebook page of the Riverfolk Music and Arts. We're both very grateful for your listenership and for your viewership and for your support. Thank you very much.
There's a 7-year-old viewer wants to know how old you were when you started playing piano.
Okay. I'm imagining that you all heard that question, but in case you didn't, a 7-year-old viewer would like to know how old I was when I started to learn how to play the piano. And I would just like monkey around with the piano when we were kind of young. I bet you my sister Laura will remember this story, but my dad won an organ in a church raffle, and we had the opportunity to trade it for a color TV and a piano. And naturally, we all wanted that color TV, so we did that, and all of a sudden we had a little piano, and Laura was taking piano lessons, and I would just go and pet the piano. You know, I didn't have any idea what I was doing with it, but I really didn't learn to play the piano till I was quite a whole lot older, probably 15 years old was really, maybe just a little younger than that. So if you're only 7 and you're thinking life has passed you by and it's too late, it is not too late to learn. Not too late. You get a great head start. So do what you love. If you love to play that piano, now's the time, as Charlie Parker would say. So my age was about 15, okay? And let's see. Someone loved that tune, that's good. I'm happy to know that. Are there any other questions from the audience? Let them fly, man, let them fly. We're here to answer them for you. Okay, how are we doing on our time? Oh my goodness gracious, this time goes by way, way, way too fast. It's funny when you talk so much, right, Mr. B? Okay, we've got a little bit longer. We have time to play a couple more pieces. And thanking everybody again, and let's get after it. We're gonna play one more of my original pieces that people ask for frequently. I played it earlier today, in fact, for some of the folks that tune into our happy half hours every weekday at 5:30, MRB Piano on Facebook. I'm going to play that for you, and then we're going to end off with one of the greatest of all the piano blues, and I'll tell a little story about that before we begin. Is there another question coming in, Wendy?
Or just a comment. Rock okay. On. Love the church sound.
Okay, great. All right. Well, I dig that name, the person that made that comment.
Also, there is another question. An 11-year-old wants to know, what's your favorite song?
Ooh, man. I'm going to guess, I don't want to be a smart aleck. I think what you're meaning is probably, what is my favorite song to play, is probably what you mean. And I think it would be maybe the one that I just played, possibly. Maybe My Sunday Best or Little Brother, or very, very possibly this next one. I love to play this. So this is called The Hallelujah Train. And what this does is this mixes elements of very traditional, old-fashioned freight train style boogie-woogie with contemporary gospel harmonies and feelings. And so it's an amalgam, and it feels totally natural to me. And so I'm glad to have invented this song. This is called The Hallelujah Train, and we hope you love it. Okay. Thank you. Hallelujah train. Hallelujah. Yes. All right. Well, the time has gone by very quickly. Hey, come and get it again. All right. I'm going to do a quick little plug. If you folks dig this kind of music, check out our friends out on the West Coast. Look for Steve Lucky and the Rumba Bums every Saturday night, 11 p.m. Eastern. Steve Lucky and the Rumba Bums featuring Miss Carmen Get It, okay? All right, we got time to play one more tune, then I think we got to close out. I don't want to overrun our welcome. Would like to thank Riverfolk Music and Arts one more time for hosting this, for allowing me the opportunity to come into your homes, share my music with you, and allow you an opportunity to support their organization and myself. And we are in times of need right now indeed. So thank you so very much. I really hope you've enjoyed it. Remember, you can all find me on my Facebook page, which is, I have two of them, MRB Piano will take you to me, or also Mr. B, Mark Lincoln Braun. And you can reach out to me and find me that way if you'd like to have a further conversation of any kind. So thank you for your support. Let's finish with the St. Louis Blues. This is the very first published blues from the father of the blues from Memphis, Tennessee, W.C. Handy. This is one of the most popular, enduring of all the blues that have been written and recorded by thousands and thousands and thousands of musicians. It really lends itself to personal interpretation. So I'll scratch your throat. Excuse me for the coughing. All right. Let's play the St. Louis Blues. This goes out to Carmen. Here you go, Patsy. This is just for you now. Thank you. Thank you. Love and good health to each and every one of you.